Thanksgiving's now over. The holiday many people enjoy while overindulging in the golden brown turkey that's packed with grandma's homemade stuffing. His mashed potatoes piled high as the gravy waterfalls over some of those lumps that mother didn't quite get rid of. The freshly baked pumpkin and apple pies are a feast unlike any other you've had since the year before. Yeah, that holiday is now come and gone. Just over the horizon, Christmas soon to come. Every year at this time, those browns, yellows, and oranges of Thanksgiving get packed away for the reds and greens, silvers and golds of the true holiday season. That fold-out tissue paper turkey with the buckled pilgrim's hat gets replaced with the jolly face of Santa Claus himself. Cinnamons and pines bouquet the air while soft twinkling lights peer through ornament-filled branches of a tree in the front room window. Landscapes with bare-leaf trees of a summer past stand in the shadows of a few hardy evergreens. You notice the crispness outside as the tip of your nose reddens with a bite by little Jack Frost. It's that time of year when the new Sears catalog comes in the mail, and what child didn't flip through to the toy section wanting everything they saw? Parents get caught up in the hustle and bustle while the kids hardly contain themselves with anticipation of a Christmas morning glory. It's when a flood of presents seem to spill out from under a lit tree the morning of. Oh, what wonderful things could be hidden behind that festive, shiny paper in hopes that Santa had fulfilled his duty and brought all on their wish lists. About 2 weeks before Christmas, the holiday season would get underway when my father would come up from the basement into the living room with a couple of barely square cardboard boxes that had been clinging to life by aged packing tape. Xmas ornaments, penned in a semi-faded black marker donned the loose flaps of the box tops. Those basement-y scented boxes were the official sign that Christmas was coming in my house. Then it was time to pick out a tree, but after dinner, of course. We would head out to the makeshift tree lot in Carvel's ice cream shop parking lot. As we parked the car, I saw through the back window what would be one of the first Christmas scenes of the season to come. Strings of impure white lights entwined between 2x4s and poles, casting a soft glow over the many orphaned blue spruce and balsam firs. I could not help but notice the heavenly aroma of a pine tree forest surrounding us as my parents ultimately decided the temporary fostering of the perfect tree. Yeah, these were just more signs of a Christmas coming. Once home, the true fun was about to begin for my father. The first accessory to emerge the ornament boxes was a good old tree stand. That flimsy one that when you put the tree in through that red ring and into its matching colored bowl, the three green legs that seemed to bend out of place with ease like a wiry ornament hook? Yeah, that one. The process of getting the tree in that stand would have to be repeated again and possibly again, but not before my father laced the room with lightning bolts of vulgar adjectives specific to the stand itself. I'd just sit back on the couch and make sure I wasn't in the way or I would get the lightning strike too. Next up in the fight against my father were the strands of the knotted tree lights. That one-of-a-kind sound of the plastic flower-like petals that vase each bulb clack and clatter as if they were themselves a band of sleigh bells. More of my father's descriptive bad words mumbled aloud and fell on deaf ears, though I heard each syllable because he would now have to test each strand. Set after set got plugged in. Some were perfect while others were half-lit, and to search the line to find which bulbs the culprit was a tedious job he had no desire to work. My mother would then step in for second shift and put on the silvery aluminum garland, and once in place, my brother, sister, and I could start hanging the ornaments. Some were personalized and some were made by us kids in school the year before. There were the basic colored glass balls and then the old ones we couldn't touch because we'd probably drop and break them. After we could reach no more, my mother finished and adjusted some of the ornaments we hung that were too close together, and she put the final touches on the tree with lots and lots of tinsel. It had to be draped evenly, too. There had to be a balance, and it had to hang nice and straight, not carelessly flopped over the other branches. Christmas decorations and knick-knacks of the same would have a way with drawing me into this mini world of Christmas. The pieces my mother made in ceramic classes, like the kissing Mr. and Mrs. Claus, or even the Christmas tree that had actual working lights and snow upon the branches. These kept me intrigued as I sat in front of them imagining a small Christmas town. Then before long I get reeled back in by my mother that it was time for bed. We had school tomorrow. In school during the days leading up to the holiday break, bulletin boards would get a seasonal facelift with candy cane borders and green construction paper backgrounds. Music class, the kids would sing in their individual keys, songs like Jingle Bells or I'm Getting Nothing for Christmas, all while a smiling teacher played away on the piano, encouraging us all that we sounded like the perfect choir. During art class, materials like glitter and cotton balls, popsicle sticks, and paste were out. There's sequins, colored pipe cleaners, styrofoam balls, all these cluttered each table so we can make some sort of elementary decoration that hopefully your mother could put out every year around this time. On that last half day before Christmas vacation, we'd have a party in the classroom. We put our Secret Santa gifts in a small box by the tabletop Christmas tree while the teacher wrote in red chalk Merry Christmas on the blackboard, which was outlined in a skimpy, tinsely green garland. The caliphone turntable played a crackly, popping vinyl record of Alvin and the Chipmunks' Christmas Don't Be Late and Gayla Peavy's I Want a Hippopotamus for Christmas. Freshly run off ditto sheets of Frosty the Snowman or Rudolph connected dots were handed out. Unknown to us, we still needed to complete some sort of curricular activities, and they were just well disguised. To make the celebration that much more fun, cookies and candies, along with tumblers of soda as a festive snack, were handed out before the school day came to a close. Off the school bus and walking up the driveway as the first few minutes of the Christmas break began, I noticed candles with deep orange bulbs aglow in all our windows. By the simplicity of it, my own house looked part of a Santa's village. Once inside, I'd take a casual stroll by my stocking and give it a little squeeze. I just had to check to see if Santa stopped by earlier to leave a little something, maybe due to a possible test run with his reindeer and sleigh. Well, that's what I thought. Empty. At 8 o'clock in the evening, my brother, sister, and I would be all showered up and have had our nightly snack, for the Christmas specials were on TV. Those Rankin and Bass claymation cartoons of Rudolph and Santa Claus is Coming to Town, or even that Grinchy Green Grinch. The whole family had gathered to watch as my brother and I laid in our favorite spots on the floor with our pillows in front of the set. Awake on the morning of Christmas Eve and excited as ever, for tonight we get to open a couple of presents. Sure, seeing the family of cousins and aunts and uncles and grandparents, it's great, but who are we kidding? It's the beginning of those presents we've waited all year for. Us kids waiting impatiently for present time, while our parents continue to drag us along with the repeated line, "In a couple of minutes we'll open presents, yeah, in a bit." And then another glass of wine gets poured or an eggnog gets topped off. The minutes going by like years, waiting and waiting. And then, oh, finally, an adult enters the room. "It's time for presents!" Adults finding seats on the couches after stepping over an obstacle course of kids sitting Indian style on the floor before the big Santa's box. An uncle steps over to the festive treasure chest of goodies while donned in a red and white cap to play Santa. One gift after another comes out, each tag read aloud to its rightful owner. "From Santa," the tags read. Tearing paper along with oohs and ahs of "look what I got" flood the room, faces smiling and grinning as parents take it all in. Oh, the joyous chaos is in the air. Then before long, the party slows down and comes to an end. It's time to get back home and into bed, because Santa Claus comes tonight. I've never changed into pajamas so fast. The covers pulled high as I lay on my back, whispering out into the darkness to my brother, who was across the room. "I can't wait for tomorrow. What do you think we'll get?" We'd share our wish list back and forth for the first time with each other, but only for a moment. Then we'd roll over and squeeze our eyes shut tight and suddenly drift off. Just a few short hours later, my eyes open. It's Christmas. Being up before everyone, including the daylight, I turn the knob to my door ever so quietly to go and greet Christmas Day. Tiptoeing around in a dimly lit living room, I could just make out the many shapes of what Santa left for us. He was here, and he had come. I sat quietly on the couch watching the room grow brighter as the morning carried on. One by one, each family member emerged from their slumber. Finally, Christmas had begun. All the gifts that Santa brought had been divvied up to its proper recipient, and then we tore in. The ripping of gift wrap between three kids in a small living room was near deafening. Hills of paper littered the chocolate shag rug while the garbage bag lay flat and empty. From one present to the next, we barely recollect the last. Then, after all had been opened, it was time for batteries, instruction deciphering, and tools to remove toys of their packaging. At this point, with all the new toys, who were we to sit and compare them to our wish list? I wasn't worried if something was missing off my list. What I had gotten was even better than I had imagined or even wished for. It was Christmas Day and I was alive as can be because Santa had come. I had made the nice list. Though it had been a long year, it couldn't end any better, for it truly was a very Merry Christmas. Well, today, as I sit back and recall all those past Christmases, I realize that each and every one of us has our own Christmas time memory. They bring us back to what seemed a simpler time, and no matter what generation, our youth will always be a simpler time. And just like then, now, and every year forward, we shall all feel and share the magic in the air that is Christmas.